Well, thank you so much. It's so great to see all of you here. And first of all, I'd like to thank our trustees who have made this possible. In particular, I would like to thank Shannon and Tim Patton, who are big supporters of our programs. I want to thank those of you who are in advancement who have made this possible for us. And I want to thank some dear friends who are here. It is so good to see all of you. And it's been a year now that I have established this wonderful friendship with Bernadette LaPaglia. And it was at this very event that we had solidified such a friendship. So this is something that's dear to my heart, that we as a community get to be together to talk about issues. They can't hear? Okay. How about if I hold it there? Is that a little better? Okay. All right. So my topic for the day is we're going to be talking about the culture wars as seen through the lens of Supreme Court cases which are currently on the Supreme Court's docket. But I don't want to add any more fuel to the fire of emotions that already exist. So what I'm going to seek to do is I'm going to seek to present a dispassionate framework by which we might be able to reason about questions of justice with some of the cases that you will undoubtedly be hearing about in June when these are decided, but some have already been in the news. So this is the framework for how I would like to proceed. First of all, I'd like to talk about justice. And maybe I'm going to ask you the awkward question, what is justice? That is something I ask my students, and boy, they do not appreciate when I ask them those kinds of difficult questions. But after we get our framework in place, then we're going to be looking at some of the cases and applying it. Okay, so let's start. Aristotle, and from whom Thomas Aquinas had borrowed very heavily, gave a lot of thought to different virtues. And he gave a lot of thought to the question of justice. Now, the most fundamental definition of justice, the simplest definition, is simply giving to each their due. And it was Aristotle who understood that justice is always right proportion in relationships. And one of the great services that he did to us in thinking about justice is that he recognized that not all justice is alike, that there are two major categories. And the first of these major categories has a huge name. It's called commutative justice. Can you believe that I actually got that out of my mouth? Commutative justice. And what this is justice between individuals in right proportion. And the two basic kinds of commutative justice, and we're all very familiar with these, the first is reciprocity. I do something nice for you, you do something nice for me. So keeping it in a right proportion. And the second kind is to rectify a wrong. For instance, if I had Bernadette over to my home and I have this little shelter dog named Rosie, and she is a little terror. And because I didn't have Rosie, who was well controlled, Bernadette ended up being injured, I would be responsible for that because I was negligent. And to put things in right proportion with my friend, I would need to pay her medical bills. Are we understanding the two kinds of justice in terms of commutative? One is between individuals, and there's these two subtypes. But there's another major kind of justice, and this is distributive justice. And this is what most of politics deals with, most but not all. And we can think of distributive justice if we think of a big cake. And it's a question of how do we divide up the shares of something, either something that we all want, like a cake, in terms of how much does each person get, or taxation would also have issues of distributive justice. In this case, it's burdens none of us want, but we all have to share them in some way. Okay. So in terms of our faith is primarily concerned with commutative justice. It's primarily concerned about justice in right proportion with other individuals. Oftentimes, we are required even to go beyond justice with the command, for instance, to love your enemies. But recall that in Matthew 7, it is said, the golden rule, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. It's a very basic principle of commutative justice. Our faith actually has far less to say about distributive justice. And indeed, we do allow for a fair amount of injustice to exist for something like taxation. Essentially, you just accept sometimes some things that are unjust. You don't expect it to be a perfect world. But we do expect that everybody should be respected and that everybody's dignity ought to be taken into account. Okay, so this is my framework, justice. Now I want to look at four Supreme Court cases, and we're going to apply these frameworks to them. And the first of the cases we're going to consider is called 303 Creative LLC versus Elements. But we'll just call it the Laurie Smith case. And we'll call it the Laurie Smith case because it's really about a private person, a Christian woman who has decided that she would like to produce web pages celebrating people's marriages and use her creative gifts in this way. But because she's Christian, she does not want to recognize or celebrate same-sex marriages. And she has sought an injunction, that's an order to prevent the government from enforcing a law, an anti-discrimination law against her in Colorado. And she, in the 10th Circuit, has been told that, yes, we believe that forcing you to create these web pages would violate your faith and it would violate your speech, but that's too bad. It's too bad because the state has a compelling interest in requiring that you provide your unique services to same-sex couples, that we're going to require this. Okay, well, she's claiming, first of all, that this is a violation of her free exercise of religion. And on that basis, she's seeking something called a conduct exemption. This means that, well, that law might be fine generally, but because of my faith and how it applies to me, I would like to have an exception. It's not only would I like, it's required by the First Amendment to have an exception. She's also claiming a violation of freedom of speech, saying, the government is compelling me to use my artistic talents to communicate a message that I don't want to say. Now, these are very strong arguments. But as I mentioned, I want to take a look at it through this other lens, this lens which isn't so legalistic, but goes back to questions of justice. And of course, this isn't how the Supreme Court, we don't expect that it will use this lens, but I want to show you the value of a liberal arts education in thinking about these kinds of issues. It's actually very practical. Now, when this went before the court for argument, various justices, especially Justice Sotomayor, were making the argument that what she is a public accommodation. And a public accommodation, she has a good that is so indispensable that she can't pick and choose who she's going to provide this for. So they're trying to fit her into the mold of distributive justice, like this one individual has this enormous pie that, you know, we have to require that it be shared with all comers. But that strikes most of us as ridiculous. This is really a commutative justice case. We're dealing with a private individual, and a private individual who is saying, I don't owe you anything. I don't have to be engaged in this. And she's right, because she's not a commodity. She's a person, first and foremost. And as a person, she has a conscience. And as a person with a conscience, her first obligation is to God. And that is something which, if you have a commutative justice framework, there's no injustice here. But it's worth testing, because do unto others as you would have them do to you. If we accept that, the implication is that we must accept that there would be gay or lesbian web designers who will refuse to create websites for our marriages. I say, okay. You don't know it. Okay? Justice. Because the alternative is that we're going to be forcing a kind of ideology upon this individual, which is deeply unjust to her as a person. Now, I want to contrast this with another case that you probably have heard as well by the Supreme Court. And this is the case of Gonzalez versus Google. I'm sure you've heard of the internet cases that are before the court right now. Well, in Gonzalez v. Google, what we have is a young woman, 23 years old, an American who was studying in Paris, and she was killed by ISIS terrorists in 2015 when they attacked a diner. Terrible tragedy. But her family is seeking to hold Google responsible because ISIS terrorists had posted material using Google. So what's at issue in this case is that Congress has passed different pieces of legislation to protect interactive computer service providers. That's a lot to put together, isn't it? It's quite a mouthful. And Congress has protected them in two ways. First, Congress protects them so that they cannot be liable for a third party's post. And that seems to be the kind of case we have here. ISIS has posted this. It looks like this is going to not be successful for her. But there's another kind of protection that Congress has provided to Google and Twitter and other kinds of organizations. And this is the protection that it can take down anybody's post it can ban you from using their services as long as they are acting in good faith. Okay. Wondering if any of you are seeing the irony that Google gets to pick who they're going to serve, but Lori Smith can't? Wow. Well, I want to suggest to you that these two different provisions are based on different kinds of justice. The first provision that Congress has passed, saying that you can't be responsible for a third party's post, well, that is consistent with commutative justice because you weren't the one who injured anybody. And it fits because Google fits within distributive justice. What they have is an indispensable pie that each one of us, to function in our daily lives, are probably going to need some access from. And if not Google, it's going to be Twitter, or it's going to be GoFundMe, or it's going to be some kind of provider of services. So the fact that in this case, Congress is protecting an entity like Google so that it gets to pick and choose according to its own idiosyncratic criteria who gets served when it's indispensable, that's a violation of another kind of justice. I'm not saying that you can't have criteria, but it does strike me to be odd that it's left up to Google to decide these things, rather than we the people through our elected officials who are going to be deliberating about something like that. And it's obviously the case that whoever controls that kind of medium does engage in censorship and ideological indoctrination, potentially on a large scale. Look only at China if you want to see that controlling the messages matters tremendously to the health of a nation. Okay, we're going to look at a third case, testing our frameworks here. And the third case we're going to look at, maybe you've heard of it. It's called Students for Fair Admissions versus Harvard. Yes, we've heard of this one. And it has a companion case. And the companion case is Students for Fair Admissions versus the University of North Carolina. And there's legal reasons for the fact that they need to have both of these brought in tandem. But what's at issue in this case, as undoubtedly you know, is that the Supreme Court has for decades now allowed race to be used in the assessment of who's going to get a spot in a highly valuable university like Harvard or what have you. You can take race into account as long as you don't have quotas or you don't use a plus factor, is what the Supreme Court has said. Now, Students for Fair Admissions, they are predominantly Asian students, and they believe that they are being discriminated against. They believe they are being discriminated against because they have evidence that it does look like quotas are being used at Harvard. If I read the brief, and from 2009 to 2019, The percentage of the incoming class at Harvard that were African American has always been between 10 to 12%, year after year after year. It's always 10 to 12%. And the percentage of Hispanics has always been between 8 to 12%. And the percentage of Asians is always about 20%. Isn't that remarkable? No quotas, and it's so perfect. Okay. They also have, and this is in the case of the University of North Carolina, that I suppose it was with Discovery, I don't know where that they got these little juicy bits of information in terms of the communication that happened with the admissions office. But there's all sorts of what seem to be, you know, dicey, somewhat racist statements that are on record, statements like, if it's brown and over 1300 SAT, give it merit. Ooh, that doesn't sound good. Right. Okay, so how do we reason about this? Is this commutative or distributive justice? I think at this point you can guess. This looks much more like Google. This is organizations that have very valuable resources, scarce seats, and they're deciding how to distribute it amongst a pool in which there's more demand than there is supply. Now, it's true within our faith, as I said, that there's no particular requirement in terms of how distributions should take place. It does say the last shall be first. It instructs us to treat everybody as a human being and respect their dignity. But it doesn't say exactly that there's one kind of principle according to which distribution should take place. But the two kinds of distributions, as Aristotle noted, that are usually most justifiable are merit and need. They're not legacy and color, which de facto is how a lot of these seats are being distributed. So it remains to be seen, but it's prima facie, not within the faith, but just what we know about justice. Those are harder categories to justify if you're going to treat everybody as a human being and not just check a box. Okay, last case. And then we can open it up for discussion, if you'd like to have a discussion. The last case that we're going to consider is Tyler versus Hennepin County. And this is a case that involves a 93-year-old woman, and her name is Geraldine Tyler. And Mrs. Tyler found herself $2,300 in arrears in paying her taxes, her property taxes. And as a result of penalties for late fees, interest, this has ballooned to $15,000. Now, what Hennepin County did within Minnesota, and it has the legal right to do this, is that it seized her property and sold it to get the amount of money that's owing to it. The amount of money that was owing to it was $15,000. It sold it for $40,000 and claims that it has a right to keep it all. And claims it has a right to keep it all because it's one of 14 states that has something called civil forfeitures, which allowed this sort of thing to happen. Now, of course, when this goes to the Supreme Court, they're framing it in terms of this is an illegal taking under the Fifth Amendment, or it's unusual punishment under the Eighth Amendment. But we're going back to Aristotle. We're keeping it simple, okay? And Aristotle says this is commutative justice. Sure, she had a debt. She owed money. She owed $15,000. Period. That's it. It's a balance. You put them back in terms of exactly where you're supposed to, and that's it. That's what justice demands. Okay. So I'm going to wrap this up, and we can open it up for discussion. So I hope that we can see that we have the resources that are based within a liberal arts education to reason dispassionately about questions of justice as they relate to the culture wars that we are in. Now, justice is not the same thing as law. So the fact that we can reason about these things and we can see what's the fair outcome, that doesn't mean that's going to happen, because law has its own language and the two don't always line up. Nor should we expect that they ever line up. That as Catholics, we know in the political domain, this is not heaven. Earth and our earthly existence is a realm of imperfection. We should just expect that. With that said, each one of us, as participants in a collective political order, we can, through our reasoning, help to push our laws closer to that approximation of justice with the language that we have inherited from our patrimony going back thousands of years. And I tell you, I am so grateful that we live in the United States, in which we are able to talk about issues like this, to convince one another. And I thank you for deliberating with me, and I'm going to open it up for questions. Yes?
This could be a really stupid question.
Oh, no, not a stupid question.
If it is, just say a stupid question. But it might be too off topic. Anyways, I was just wondering, with in Aristotle's time, was there anything that was like an ancient precedent of Google? Because, you know, like, Google is a kind of like a unique, I mean, as the world progresses, you obviously have like newspaper and you have the printing press and all these things, and so you have to keep on applying the principles of justice to these things. But was there anything even close to that around the time of Aristotle that he would have been thinking about?
Oh, that's a really good question. And, you know, I cannot think of anything that would be remotely similar to Google. I suppose it might be the agora, you know, the common meeting place in which people would come together for the purpose of sharing ideas. And the fact that you were a citizen meant that you could come together and discuss and share these ideas. Not that sometimes there couldn't be consequences, that maybe you would need to be exiled, but, you know, you wouldn't have a kind of exile that somebody, some private entity within the agora got to say, hey, you can be here and everybody else has to go. So it's a really good question that you're asking. So thank you for being so thought-provoking. Yeah, yes.
I would just want to not try to answer that question, but perhaps add something to it.
Oh, good.
To me, it always has, for a long time at least, it has seemed that the beauty of the Constitution of the United States is that it still applies. There was no Google in 18 whatever it was,
yes.
Right?
That's right, at our founding.
There there were more things than there were during the days of Aristotle, greater ways to make a greater impact on a greater number of people, but still there wasn't Google. And so it's, I think things, if not everything, I would hope everything, could be brought back to that common element as the Constitution does today, and that's why it can apply to things like Google and cake bakers and content makers on the internet.
Excellent point that you're making. And I just want to reinforce the level of injustice that is being experienced by the cake bakers and the like. And I'm sure that you have probably all heard of Jack Phillips. He is the owner of Masterpiece Bakery. That's the case that originally went before the Supreme Court. I think it was 2018. The Supreme Court essentially punted that at that time, because the Supreme Court in that case simply said that the Colorado Human Rights Commission treated them unjustly because there was all this anti-Christian rhetoric that was in their decision, just meaning that if the Colorado Human Rights Commission zips it, that, you know, the case doesn't have precedential value. So it's come back. And in the case of Jack Phillips, in 2021, he found himself again before the Colorado Human Rights Commission, this time because he wouldn't bake a cake for a coming out transgendered party. And he's going massively in debt for the purpose of fighting these things. And again, one of the ironies of this, there's another woman, she's now gotten out of the florist business, but she was the owner of something called Arlene's Flowers. And she fought for years and accrued millions of dollars in legal debts to say that she doesn't believe that, you know, flowers are her artistic creation. She doesn't want to have kind of an expression of support for something she doesn't believe in. Do you know GoFundMe said that according to its policy, she's discriminatory and threw her off for the GoFundMe page. So GoFundMe doesn't have to provide services, but she does. Yes.
Dr. Sugrue, in the three cases that you mentioned, it all involved some form of a creative expression. So the
objections.
But there are also cases making their way through the courts of pharmacists refusing to sell abortifacients and or provide birth control. Do you think that there is positive precedent for the extending the protections, or in this case where they're simply retailing a product that they had no control over making or manufacturing, that they're going to find themselves less of a leg to stand on?
That's a really good question that you're asking, and we'll divide it up both in terms of legally how the Supreme Court is likely to treat it, as well as according to the framework that I put forward, because I haven't put forward the framework that the court reasons in. I'm trying to suggest something that even somebody who doesn't have a legal education, we can still reason about these things. But legally, even though the free speech clause may not apply because you're not dealing with artistic expression, the free exercise clause should still apply. Is that if you have a sincere belief that something is an action is contrary to your faith. For instance, at Ave Maria University, we fought this for a long time with the Obama administration, that we did not want to have to fund for birth control pills when that was something that was mandated. And the Supreme Court didn't want to decide that. They just kept kind of punting it, encouraging some kind of negotiation until the Obama administration came to an end. But I think this Supreme Court will protect religious practices, just given everything that I have seen. In their own way, I think they're bringing back the conduct exemption. If for anybody who might be in this area, we can talk about that. So I think legally, Not all of the Constitution would apply, but I think some of it still would. If we talk in terms of justice, I think what I'm saying works is when you're dealing with one-on-one interactions, that one person in conscience who believes they can't distribute this is in the commutative justice framework. It would be a bigger deal if it were a company that were deciding for all of America essentially what our birth control policies were. And that would strike us as so unfathomable that that's something that, you know, ought to be within a collective deliberation, that you would have it within the distributive justice framework. I see no reason why you're forcing people to act contrary to their conscience. I mean, again, you're not a commodity, you're a person. That's what we're dealing with in these cases. Yes.
Yeah. Well, I was just thinking that the person kind of is a commodity in the sense when they're working for a company, like, you know, Walgreens or something, you know, and the pharmacist is Walgreens' commodity.
It is, but because Walgreens is a commodity, they can certainly have other options. Is that they're not required to compromise the conscience of any given person.
Yeah.
So, you know, get somebody else then. Yes?
In a different area of that same case, you have Walgreens in California has decided not to have them, and therefore you have a governor who's going against it. What is your framework? How does that relate to that situation where now you have Walgreens versus a governor who says we won't do business with you anymore, in that sense?
It's a little more complicated than even that, because Walgreens is acting by the pressures that exist in other states. And so they're trying to have a one-size-fits-all policy. And in trying to accommodate some states, it's finding now that it's in a conflict with California. And so these are things that obviously cannot be decided by Walgreens. This is something that is, you're dealing with a distributive issue that matters tremendously to all of us, and which is within the range of what we should expect that our public officials will deal with. Now, for the time being, contraception is treated like a right by the Supreme Court, going back to Griswold v. Connecticut. But of course, we'll see with the Dobbs decision, that's undermined it, so that could change. Any other thoughts or questions? Yes?
Do you have a prediction on the outcome of the affirmative action cases before the Supreme Court?
I think race will no longer be a criteria that will be used or permissible. That's my guess. It's interesting that in the Grutter v. Bollinger case going back to 2001, where they allowed this, Justice O'Connor also said that she predicts this is a temporary measure, 25 years, and we have to stop using that. Well, it's almost 25 years. Any other thoughts or questions? I could be wrong. I mean, the worst thing in the world you can do is predict, but I did anyway. All right, you're a wonderful group. Thank you so much. Yeah.